Good morning, everybody, and welcome to our service of morning prayer this morning. It's good to be here. I hope you've been enjoying the beautiful weather that we've been having, yes? It's been great, hasn't it, just to get out and to enjoy the sunshine. And I think that always makes us smile, always makes me smile. As does Michael's mask with his wonderful smiling face.
I've had no occasion to turn it over yet.
So it's good to be here this morning. Yeah, great. A sentence to start us off this morning. You know the generous grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that by his poverty he could make you rich. I'm going to put the words up on the screen that if you've got your booklet, no booklets, yeah. Follow the words on the screen then. Just as well we did that. Grace, mercy and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Be with you.
And also with you.
We're going to start with a hymn, and the music group are going to sing to us. If you want to sort of mouth the words or whatever you want to do, but you can certainly follow the words on the screen.
Oh,
So we come to our prayers of confession. We have come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving. Hear and receive God's word and to pray for the needs of the world and to seek forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit we may give ourselves to the service of God.
Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew the right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
May the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image, to the praise and glory of his name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed is the Lord,
for he has heard the voice of our prayer.
Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy,
and in our song we will praise our God.
So we're going to have another song in which we're going to praise our God.
Mercy.
we will respond to that by saying the words in bold. Splendour and majesty are yours, O God. You are exalted as head over all.
Blessed are you, God of Israel, forever and ever. For yours is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendour and the majesty. Everything in heaven and on earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head over all. Riches and honour come from you, and as you rule over all. In your hand are power and might. Yours it is to give power and strength to all. And now we give you thanks, our God, and praise to your glorious name. For all things come from you, and of your own we give you.
We're now going to have our readings from Scripture. Our first reading is our New Testament reading from 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 1 to 9. Carol's coming to read. Thank you, Carol.
And now, brothers and sisters, we want you to know about the grace that God has given to the Macedonian churches. In the midst of a very severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. For I testify that they gave as much as they were able and even beyond their ability. Entirely on their own, they urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in this service to the Lord's people, and they exceeded our expectations. They gave themselves first of all to the Lord, and then by the will of God also to us. So we urge Titus, just as he had earlier made a beginning, to bring also to completion this act of grace on your part. But since you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in the love we have kindled in you, see that you also excel in this grace of giving. I'm not commanding you, but I want to test the sincerity of your love by comparing it with the earnestness of others. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might become rich.
Yes.
This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 26, beginning to read at verse 6. While Jesus was in Bethany, in the home of a man known as Simon the leper, a woman came to him with an alabaster jar of very expensive perfume, which she poured on his head as he was reclining at the table. When the disciples saw this, they were indignant. "Why this waste?" they asked. "This perfume could have been sold at a high price and the money given to the poor." Aware of this, Jesus said to them, "Why are you bothering this woman? She has done a beautiful thing to me. The poor you will always have with you, but you will not always have me. When she poured this perfume on my body, she did it to prepare me for burial. I tell you the truth, wherever this gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, John. So, today we begin a 4-week series for our Sunday services and midweek home groups entitled Overflowing Grace. It's based mostly on Paul's second letter to the Corinthian church. We'll be thinking about giving and how it relates to our faith. Paul's remarks on the topic take up 2 whole chapters in this letter, so clearly he sees it as a matter of importance. And this is not just because of pressing need. In these passages, Paul presents a bigger picture of what giving is all about. He wants the Corinthian church to grasp a different perspective, one that perhaps they'd lost. To us, his earnest pleas may come across simply as an emotional appeal for money, perhaps even a cynical attempt to exploit the Corinthians' goodwill. But I think that would be to misinterpret Paul's words and to misrepresent his intentions. He has in mind the Corinthians' spiritual health and well-being. He wants them to up their game, not out of shame or duty, but by elevating their thinking. He wants them to understand that generosity is not just a practical necessity, but a vital expression of faith. To envisage giving as God's means of blessing, not just of the recipient, but also the giver. There's an episode of the cartoon series The Simpsons in which Homer walks in on his children, Bart and Lisa, having a humdinger of a row. "Hey, what's going on?" he asks. "We're arguing about who loves you the most," Bart replies. "Ah, that's nice," says Homer. "Then carry on." So they resume their argument. "You do. No, you do." In our reading today, Paul compares the Corinthians and their sister church in Macedonia with respect to their giving. At first blush, it appears as if he wants to induce a bit of healthy competition, or perhaps to shame the Corinthian church into supporting his cause. But Paul's concern is really elsewhere, for whilst he tells of many ways in which the Corinthian church excels, he sees that they have not grasped, or that they have forgotten, the importance of giving as an essential outworking of faith. So, what's the background? What's been going on? In the year 52, Paul visits Peter and the apostles in Jerusalem and discusses his mission and the relationship of his non-Jewish churches to the mother church. It seems at that time that the church in Jerusalem faced opposition within the wider Jewish society and significant financial hardship. After affirming Paul's ministry, the apostles ask only that he remember the poor, something Paul writes elsewhere that he was only too eager to do. So, Paul undertakes to make a collection for the Jerusalem church. It was important to Paul's apostolic ministry for several reasons. He'd experienced firsthand the Jerusalem Christians' need for humanitarian support. Moreover, here was an opportunity for Christians to stand together, to acknowledge the sacrificial debt of service of the Mother Church in spreading the gospel, to forge a unity between churches near and far, and within amongst Jew and non-Jew. One scholar has described Paul's collection for the church in Jerusalem as an illustrative model of his theology, that is, a practical display of faith in action. For elsewhere in his letter, Paul says that those who are in Christ are called to be part of one body, the ecclesia, the church, the body of Christ, whether near or far, male or female, Jew or non-Jew. The church is the first fruit, the beginning of the incoming kingdom, God's redemptive pattern for the transformation of the whole of society, whose foundation is the love of God. That love, he says, we see in Jesus, who gave his life for others, who, though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that by his poverty you might become rich. Giving is a part of living out the faith, of following in Jesus' footsteps. They say that it's often the financially less well-off who are more responsive to charitable appeals. Perhaps the experience of poverty makes us more empathetic for others in the same boat, or makes us know the real importance of money. The Macedonian church, in its rural peasant hand-to-mouth existence, knew poverty. But though they were poor, they also knew God's provision. They were able to see themselves as rich, the recipients of God's blessing, and so were freed to share that blessing with others. Paul tells us that they were ready donors who wanted to give even more than they had to the cause. In Corinth, the church was also largely drawn from the poorer section of society, but Corinth was a thrusting, affluent, cosmopolitan city where wealth meant status and poverty inferiority. In a society that told you your place at every turn, it would be easy to believe this assessment, to adopt a mindset of poverty, to discount the blessings of God, to succumb to a kind of blindness and ingratitude, such that giving becomes a duty rather than an opportunity to gratefully bless others. Both churches were poor, with perhaps relatively little to give in the way of finance. But Paul makes the comparisons in the hope that the Corinthians will see it's not about money, it's about love, and about entering into the joy of giving, being ready to give of themselves in whatever way from the blessings that they have received. He says he makes his request not as a demand, but as an opportunity for them to respond and demonstrate the genuineness of their love. Paul is challenging a wrong-headed perspective. The Victorian preacher Charles Haddon Spurgeon describes how he went with money from his church collection to help pay the rent of a poor woman in the parish. He knocked again and again, but failed to get a response. The woman was inside all right, but she didn't open the door because she thought it was the rent man. The knock signaled a gift, but she thought it was a demand. The poor woman missed out on a blessing because she had the wrong mindset. The knock signaled a gift, but she thought it was a demand. I wonder, can we be missing out in a similar way? Do we think of giving as a gift or a demand? When you think about it, every good and everything that happens in the world that is good, when you think about it, everything good that happens in the world begins somewhere along the line with giving. And James tells us that every good and perfect gift begins with God, if we would but see it. A beautiful sunset, the food we eat, the grace of forgiveness, the joy of acceptance. To give is to participate in God's work in the world. And if we want to be of any good in the world, it will involve giving. When we take time to listen, help, encourage, provide for the needs of others, we participate in the overflow of God's grace to us. Not only that, by graciously inviting us to share in the work and giving, by giving us the means, God treats us as persons, giving us the opportunity to do good, to know the joy of helping to make the world a better place, to bring forward the day when God's kingdom fully arrives. It's not wrong for us to seek God's blessing. I'm sure most of us do it every day. But God's blessing is like yeast, working in us, and then through us, till the whole world is transformed. So let's not forget what God has already blessed us, or we may miss out on the gift of blessing others. In our Gospel reading from Matthew, we heard of the woman anointing Jesus' feet with costly spikenard. She is criticised because the ointment could have been sold for a considerable amount of money and given to the poor. Jesus does not condemn her, but rather berates her accusers, who in thinking it's about the money, fail to recognise her gift as a fragrant offering of the heart, the very best she had to offer, a gift commensurate with the one that Jesus must soon make on behalf of them and us all. Mary Ann Evans, under the pen name George Eliot, wrote the poem Roses. You love roses, so do I. I wish the sky would rain down roses as they rain from off the shaken bush. Why will it not? Then all the valley would be pink and white and soft to tread on. They would fall as light as feathers, smelling sweet, and it would be like sleeping and waking all at once. But God's blessing is not magical like roses falling from the sky. It was Mary Ann Evans who also said, "It will never rain roses. When we want to have more roses, we must plant more roses." God wants us to imagine the world as a better place, but to use the gifts, our time, our talents, our money, the resources we've been given, to participate in making it so. God chooses to transform the world by transforming us, that rich in love, God's love may be seen amongst God's people and flow out to the world. May it be so. Amen.
As we just respond to what Peter has been saying, but I don't want you to forget Peter, as you want me to forget him, and listen to what God. has been saying to you, I'm going to give you the gift of silence for a few moments now, which is something this congregation does do beautifully. You're good at being silent together. I know many of you spent many silent hours alone this last year. And maybe some of you have been cramped up and haven't had enough silence. So now, we're going to have some silence together, enjoying the company and the sound of someone breathing near us, and yet still being able to be silent as we receive what God is saying to us about what we have received and what we can give. So a moment of silence. Now the music group are going to come and sing. I guess rather than singing to you or even for you, what we hope is that we're able to give voice to some of the things that are maybe in your hearts, but just for the time being you're not allowed, you can't sing out loud together. I will offer up my life in the spirit of my life, pouring out the oil of love as my worship to you.
Thank you.
thank you for the gifts and blessings that you've given to us, and what you've given to us, we just give this back to you, that you may use it in your service. Pray that you'll multiply our gifts, and that they will flow out to others. We pray this in your name. Amen. So you've been sat down for quite a while. I think it would be good now if we could just affirm our faith in the words of the creed. Please stand or feel free to sit. But let's be upstanding to say the words of the creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. Please be seated on the passion. Please in prayer.
Thank the Lord for giving us his Son and for forgiving us our sin. And when I pray, Spirit of the living God, will you please respond with, fall afresh on us. So Spirit of the living God,
fall afresh on us.
A prayer of St. Ignatius of Loyola. Lord, teach us to be generous, to serve you as you deserve, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labour and not to look for any reward save that of knowing that we do your will. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Lord, you have graciously and generously given us everything we need. Would you always show us to be gracious and generous too? Through your outrageous grace, may we live lives that are selfless and sacrificial. Teach us how we can give of our time, of our talents, and our treasures. And let us truly know how much you love a cheerful giver. Spirit of the living Lord, fall afresh on us. Lord, we pray for those nations who live in the disparity of riches and poverty, where wealth and greed for more leave those with nothing, desperate for healthy lives, hygiene and dignity. Lord, we cry out against injustice and inequality. We rage at the tyrannical, despotic leaders of countries to encounter you, that their hearts and consciences will be transformed, so that fairness and righteousness become the roots of society and healing, and hope and wholeness is lived out And Lord, give our own government a heart of compassion, integrity and wisdom, so that this overseas budget is not only reversed to its previous level, but that more is given to those countries that are teetering on the edge of catastrophic disaster. Spirit of the living Lord, fall afresh on us. Lord, for your Christian community in Calverton, may we, as true followers of Jesus, shine the light in the darkness. Give us all the courage to share what we have to those who we have contact, so that those who don't yet know you will start their own journey of discovering the richness of life in you. How will they know if they've not been told? Lord, make us make the most of moments that we have. Let us redeem every minute you have given us as we sow those seeds, trusting that they will fall on soil that is fertile and believing that you will cause these seeds to grow. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Lord, make us all hungry and thirsty for more of you. As many of us have struggled throughout lockdown, remove those junk food distractions and let us feed on more of you and your word through reading the Bible, in prayer, in worship, in contemplation. Cause us, Lord, to return to you, our first love, and be fed on the true bread of life, and drink from you the true water of life, knowing that it is only you who can truly satisfy our longings and desires. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendor, and the majesty, for everything in heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you, and of your own do we give you. Help us, Father, to live each day to the full, being true to you in every way. Jesus, help us to give ourselves away to others, being kind to everyone we meet. Spirit, help us to love the lost, proclaiming Christ in all we do and say. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. And gathering all our prayers together, we pray as our Saviour Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory of Christ, now and forever. Amen.
Let's join together in our church prayer. Generous God, may your Spirit continue to transform our lives and this church. Holy Spirit, would you guide us as we strive together to follow Jesus? Help us as we strive together to care for one another, our community and the world. Teach us as we strive together
grow in our faith. In Jesus' name we pray.
And we're going to have a hymn to finish off. Please follow the words from the tune. Here is love, vast as the ocean. We've been thinking, haven't we, of the sacrifice that Jesus made for each one of us. And we're going to just close by singing this hymn. Go in peace and serve.